Thanks, Priyamvada, for the introduction. Good evening to all of you, and thank you for joining us for this session today. My name is Amar, and I welcome you on behalf of IFI and Sankalp. I trust you have been able to attend the various interesting sessions at IFI thus far. The objective of this session is to foreground the conversation about the opportunities for micro-saving and micro-investments for women, the need for specific products and processes to enable that, and the role that digital financial services can play in the process. With the steady increase in digital financial services, as well as an increased connectivity and the push at the policy level to support women entrepreneurs, the income levels of women are expected to rise. Women thus represent an enormous number of potential clients for various savings and investment related services. This is an opportune time to develop a variety of customized wealth creation instruments for micro savers across India so that they too can benefit from the overall economic growth of the country. All our panelists today have been very intimately involved with the topic, and I'm sure all of you are as eager to hear from them as I am. We have budgeted about 50 minutes for the discussion, after which we shall do a short Q&A. And during the session too, you will see a few questions pop up on your screen as part of an audience poll, and I request you to answer them. I will now quickly reintroduce the panelists in no particular order. We have with us Mr. Satyajit Dwivedi, the CEO of NCFE, the National Center for Financial Education, the nodal agency to implement the National Strategy for Financial Education. He has previously served as the Chief General Manager at NABARD and CEO of NABKISAN, and has also served as an acclaimed faculty at the College of Agricultural Banking of RBI. He has been recognized by the Economic Times as one of the 100 most influential banking and financial services institute leaders in 2017. Thank you for joining us. We also have with us Ms. Leeds Mandeshi Foundation's Digital Literacy Program. She runs an instruments making business that regularly fulfills large orders across the country. She was a finalist at the prestigious Women Exemplar Award of the CII a couple of years ago. Alongside running her business, she has led a team that has trained over 5,000 rural women to use ATMs and adopt digital transactions, payments, apps, and services. Thank you for joining us. Then we have with us Mr. Joby, who is CEO of Dwara KGFS and leads the wealth management approach that Dwara adopts. He has held various leadership positions in the sector, including being the CEO of Varam, CFO of ESAF Microfinance, and Vice President at IFMR Capital. And last but not least, we have Mr. Shekhawat, Chief of Product and Communications for Liabilities at AU Small Finance Bank. He leads product development and customer engagement strategy for the bank and has played a key role in transforming retail liabilities at the bank. Over the last 16 years, he has helped build successful portfolios for various banks such as HDFC, ICICI, and Yes Bank. Thank you to all our panelists for making the time to join us. Before we start, I would like to request the organizers to show the first poll question, and I would request all the audience members to answer it. To start off, I would first like to request Mr. Dwivedi to speak about the findings of NCFE's recent survey on financial inclusion and financial literacy in India, and provide his perspectives on the importance of financial literacy as a first step towards effectively rolling out micro savings products. Sir, I think you're on mute.
Okay. Am I audible now? Connectivity is okay.
Yes, you are.
Thank you, Amar. Thank you so much for the nice introduction. And I wish to thank Access and Assist for inviting me to be a panelist in this discussion session. I also appreciate the initiative of Access and Assist in choosing this topical theme today for discussion in their 2 days conference that they are having. As Amar had said, when he spoke to me, I said it is better to set the context of the discussion and what best than citing some of the reports that the recent survey brings out about the rural areas and about the women in particular. So NCFE, which is the National Center for Financial Education, conducted a large scale survey pan India, covering about 75,000 respondents all over the India on the financial literacy and inclusion status in India. So first survey was conducted in 2013, and the next survey was conducted in 2018, and the reports came in 2019, which formed the basis for drawing up the National Strategy for Financial Education. So this survey has brought out very interesting findings. And one of the, I will only quote the relevant findings of the survey, which are relevant for this topic. And those of you who are interested, the survey, the detailed report is available in our website, as well as in the website of all the sector regulators. Regarding the financial literacy, I strongly believe that financial inclusion and wealth creation and savings and micro investment, all the barriers to that for the rural woman, among other things, mostly due to the low awareness level and the lack of financial literacy. These are the two main reasons which are the barriers for the rural financial inclusion, I mean the women financial inclusion. If you look at the financial literacy survey that was conducted in the report, it says, and the financial literacy index was formed by three parameters: the financial knowledge, the financial behavior, and the financial attitude. On these three parameters in the country, which was at 20% financial literacy in the year 2013, has moved to 27% in 2018-19. So within that, where do the female and the woman stand? The women constitute only 21% for the literacy. They are much below the national level at 27. They are even the gap between the male and the female is about 8%, because the male literacy level is 29%. So this is basically the financial literacy level of the woman at the nation and the vis-a-vis the male. Having said that, what the survey also did about the savings, I am restricting purely to the savings and the investment products. While they assessed the saving behavior in the last 12 months of all the respondents. And in order to assess the savings behavior in the last 12 months, they asked specific questions, how do they behave? And the savings categories, they made it into two, the active savings and the passive savings. The active savings, according to the definition, is the savings which generate income, and the passive savings which do not generate the incomes. That means the generating the income, mostly the bank deposit, saving bank's account, RD, recurring deposit, term deposits, investment in bonds and shares and things like that. These are the active savings, and the passive savings constituted three categories, mainly saving in cash, saving in family account, saving in other form, which are not generating income. Predominantly, which came out in the most common form of active saving is in the saving bank account of the bank. More than 90% said that they are saving in the saving bank account. So that comes out to be the major predominant habit in the saving behavior. And 49 of the respondents indicated that they had saved money in the last 12 months in the national level. And when it compares with the women and the men, 52% of the male said they have saved in the last 12 months, and only 40% of the women said they have saved in the last 12 months in active saving. And when we talk about the passive savings, it is, well, the national level, 88% of the respondents said they have the passive savings, mostly in the cash. 88% say cash, and 7% say in family account, and only 12% says in the other form. And where do the female and the woman stand in the form of the passive savings? The 88% same, the female are saving in cash, and the 6% are saving in family account, and 9% are saving in the other form. So this is the kind of data which has been thrown up by the survey. And another important thing which it was found was that and services, one of the reasons, how do they have the information gathering system in selecting a particular product or the services which is offered by the different financial intermediaries? So more than 90%, it's about 94% of the respondents, and the female especially, said that they do not have any, they have not gathered any information related to any product and services, and only 6% said they have some. And it is the 91% is the national average, whereas the 94% of the female said they don't have any information regarding the products and services. And when we compared the financial inclusion initiatives and the status of financial inclusion in the country, what happened is the banking and savings products in the three categories, again, in the three parameters, the survey has been conducted. It addresses the awareness, then the holding, and then the operating. Operating is the usage, and holding is the holding, and awareness is whether the person is aware of the product. So awareness is not same as the holding and operating. Awareness is just that this kind of a product exists, and the holding and the operating. And when you examine, and the respondent were surveyed, and there also what came out was that the awareness level is significantly higher compared to the holding and the operating. In all the segments of the savings bank account, whether the RD, whether the term deposit, whether any microfinance loan, or whether any insurance, pension, or any awareness level seem to be higher than the holding and the operating. Obvious reasons, they are aware, but they are not holding, and even they are holding, they are not operating. So it's across products, across sector, whether it's insurance, pension, it is like that. And there also the divide is significant. The women have always less compared to the men in terms of the awareness, in terms of holding and in terms of operating, both are compared to the national as well as their counterparts and in the different age group. So all these statistics I am not going to give you because it is available in that. Only thing which has a general level, I'll tell you that when they were assessed, the reasons for not using and reasons for not operating the various banking products and services, and 45% people said that there is no need. And more than 30% people said they don't have any knowledge. So from everything, even the pension products also, it came out like that. So in everything, what has come out very clearly is that lack of knowledge and there is no need. No need means he's aware, but he's not investing. So no need is a segment of the portion which can be addressed at the second stage. But lack of knowledge is something which needs to be addressed so that they go to that no need. Whether that means they are exercising a choice. They know the product, whether to invest or not, whether to take that product or not is the no need. So there is a need to improve this, the first stage of financial literacy and education, to make them aware of the products and the features of the product. And then they decide whether it is needed for them or whether not needed. And for the supply side issues are not much, because hardly 9% of the people said that it is because the bank is not located within a approachable limit. That is why they are not doing. So that is not one of the constraining factor from the supply side, which came out from the survey. I think I stop at this and I'll come back as and when something is referred to, because I have restricted my presentation purely onto the female and onto the savings and the investment product. Amar? I stop here.
Got it. Thanks for that. I think that sets the context very beautifully. And we had also, yeah, that's fine, sir. Thank you. So thanks for that. I think that sets the context very beautifully. And we had also asked the audience in parallel that we know that 80% of women in India have a bank account. And how many of them do you think save formally? And an overwhelming majority say that fewer than 20% of that save formally, which is actually the case. And I think it comes out from what you just described as well. And one important point you mentioned is that how the level of awareness is more than the level of holding an account and the level of operating an account. So awareness is essentially the first step in you know, making women and everybody for that matter hold these accounts and operate them. So financial literacy is a critical first step. And Mandeshi is doing some exemplary work in this field. I'd like to come to Rupali ji. Rupali ji, aapne Mandeshi Foundation ke madhyam se 5000 se adhik mahilaon ko digital literacy training diya hai. Hum aapse sunna chahenge is digital literacy program ke bare mein aur aapke anubhav ke bare mein. Rupali madam?
Yes. Ha. Main Hindi mein baat karungi sir. Aap sabko comfortable hai? Hello, meri awaaz aa rahi hai? Yes. नमस्कार सर, मेरा नाम राजेश शिंदे है और मैं मानदेसी से हूँ. मानदेसी में डिजिटल प्रोजेक्ट 2018 में शुरू हुआ है और ये प्रोजेक्ट सर ऐसा रूरल एरिया में हम ज्यादातर महिलाओं के पास काम करते हैं. जो महिला इस प्रोजेक्ट में ऐसा है कि जो महिला हमारे पास नहीं आ सकती है उस महिला के पास हम जाते हैं. जैसे कि यहाँ पर महिलाओं को ज्यादा फ्रीडम नहीं होता है, ज्यादा डिजिटल के बारे में पता नहीं होता है, उनको सीखने के लिए ये सब कुछ उनके पास हमें जाना पड़ता है. तो हमारे पास एक डिजिटल बस है, उस डिजिटल बस में एक डेमो मशीन है, एटीएम का डेमो मशीन है. तो वो और हम वीडियो भी ले लेते हैं, वीडियो भी दिखाते हैं, जैसे कि एटीएम कैसे चलाना है, ऑनलाइन पेमेंट कैसे करना है, ऐसे. और ये बस लेकर हम हर एक गांव में चले जाते हैं. तो पहला काम हमारा ये होता है कि जब भी हम एक गांव में जाते हैं तो उस गांव की सारी महिलाओं को इकट्ठा करते हैं. जैसे कि और वो महिला थोड़ी बहुत पढ़ी लिखी हो, उनका एजुकेशन हो, कम से कम उन्हें पढ़ना लिखना तो आना चाहिए. ऐसी महिलाओं को हम इकट्ठा करते हैं और उन्हें डिजिटल का क्या इंपॉर्टेंस है, एटीएम चलाना क्या इंपॉर्टेंट, उसके बारे में हम उनको बता देते हैं. लेकिन पहले हम उन्हें एटीएम का ट्रेनिंग देते समय हमारे ध्यान में एक बात आ गई कि जो रूरल एरिया में महिला होती है, छोटा मोटा बिजनेस करती है, लेकिन उनके ज्यादातर अकाउंट ही नहीं बैंक में. तो वो बोलती है कि हम एटीएम सीखकर क्या करेंगे। तो वहां से हमारा एक स्ट्रगल शुरू शुरू हो जाता है कि हम वहां से शुरुआत कर लेते हैं कि उनका पहले अकाउंट ओपन होना चाहिए और उनको सेविंग सेविंग की क्या जरूरत है, सेविंग क्यों करना चाहिए, ये यहाँ से हम उनको सिखाते हैं। बहुत कन्विंस करके उनको अकाउंट ओपन करवा लेते हैं, उनका एटीएम निकाल लेते हैं ऑनलाइन। अगर उसका एजुकेशन 10th के ऊपर है या 7th के ऊपर है, उसका मेंटेलिटी बहुत अच्छी तरह से कैप्चर करती की है, तो हम उन्हें ऑनलाइन पेमेंट का कैसे करना है, ऑनलाइन शॉपिंग कैसे करना है, गूगल गूगल पे कैसे यूज करना है, भीम ऐप कैसे यूज करना है, ये सब कुछ ऐसा सिखा देते हैं। जहाँ जो महिला, मैं फिर एक बार रिपीट करना चाहूंगी कि जो महिला हमारे पास नहीं आ सकती, उनके पास हम खुद चले जाते हैं और वो ऐसी महिलाओं को हम सिखाते हैं। अभी 2018 से हमने कम से कम 6,000 महिलाओं को ट्रेन किया है, तो उनसे बहुत अच्छी बात ये आ जाती है कि जो महिला पढ़ी की भी है, अगर उनका एजुकेशन ग्रेजुएशन भी है, तो वो एटीएम नहीं यूज करती है सर, क्योंकि उनके घर में हर एक जेंट्स एटीएम यूज कर लेते हैं, उनके घर के हर एक जेंट्स के पास उनका फाइनेंशियल कंट्रोल होता है, जैसे पैसे का सब व्यवहार उनके हाथ में होता है, लेकिन लेडीज के हाथ में कुछ भी नहीं है। लेडीज को सिर्फ घर का काम, उनकी हाउसवाइफ ऐसा, और जो भी काम है वो वही करना पड़ता है। लेकिन जब हम उनके पास जस्ट चले जाते हैं और उनको बता देते हैं कि आप उतना काम करती है, फॉर एग्जाम्पल आप खेती करती है, खेती के साथ दुग्ध व्यवसाय मिल्क बिजनेस करती है, तो वो गाय भैंस का वो सब कुछ काम कर लेती है, लेकिन उनका जो वो दूध का जो पैसा उनके पास आता है वो उनके हस्बैंड के खाते में चला जाता है। तो उनको ये बताना पड़ता है कि वो पैसा अगर आपके पास चला आए आपके खाते में आ जाए, तो आप भी जो आपके हस्बैंड करते हैं वही आप भी कर लेंगे, आपके घर के लिए वही खर्चा आप कर लेंगी। और महिलाओं का तो ज्यादा घर के बारे में बहुत ज्यादा सोचती है, तो वो सोच विचार करके ही खर्चा करती है। तो ये सब कुछ हम उनको जब बताते हैं तो उनके दिमाग में ये बात आती है कि अरे हम इतना कष्ट करते हैं तो क्यों ना हमारे पास भी इसका जो हम काम करते हैं उसके पैसे आनी चाहिए, और वो अकाउंट खुलवा लेती है। अकाउंट खोलने के बाद उनके पास पैसा चला आता है, तो उनको एटीएम चलाना, अभी हमने एटीएम तो सिखा लिया, जैसे कि डेमो मशीन पे वो महिला 3-4-5 बार जितनी चाहिए बार वो ट्राई कर सकती है, क्योंकि उनका जो उनके मन में डर रहता है कि हम ओरिजिनल मशीन के पास एटीएम मशीन में जाएंगे तो वहां पे लैंग्वेज कैसी होंगी, इंग्लिश होंगी, मराठी होंगी या हिंदी, उनको पता नहीं होता, पैसे कहाँ चले जाएंगे, ये सब कुछ उन्हें कुछ भी नहीं पता होता। लेकिन डेमो मशीन पर वो ट्राई करेगी तो उनकी कॉन्फिडेंस, सेल्फ कॉन्फिडेंस लेवल वो उनकी बढ़ जाती है, और वो हमारी महिला फर्स्ट टाइम 100 रुपीज निकाल लेती है और वो एटीएम भी चलाना सीख जाती। अभी उनको वो थोड़ा बहुत ये सीख जाती है तो एटीएम, तो उनको उनका टाइम जो टाइम है वो बच जाता है। बाद में उनको और अच्छा लगता है कि डिजिटल में हम और क्या सीख जाए, हमें और क्या चाहिए, वो हमें कॉल करके बता देते हैं कि मैम हमें और भी कुछ सीखना है, तो हमें ऑनलाइन पेमेंट हो, ऑनलाइन शॉपिंग हो, ये सब कुछ हम सिखा लेते हैं उनको। तो ऐसी बहुत सारी महिला है, मैं आपको केस स्टडी भी एक ऐसी महिलाओं को शेयर करूंगी। तो बहुत सारी महिला ऐसी है कि हर एक गांव की कोई एक महिला ऐसी भी है कि उस गांव की फर्स्ट लेडी वो डिजिटल लेडी नाम से वो जानी गई है, और वो अभी और जेंट्स को सिखाती है। तो इतना अच्छा ये डिजिटल का हमारा प्रोजेक्ट है, और हम ऐसे बहुत सारे गांव में जाकर, रूरल एरिया में जाकर उसी महिलाओं को हम ट्रेन करते हैं। अमर जी,
Got it. Thanks for that. And I think what really stands out for me is something that you said, that जो काम महिलाएं करती हैं लेकिन उनका पैसा जो आता है वो हस्बैंड के खाते में चला जाता है, and the women don't quite have the control on their own money. And this is what really stands out. And you know, it is essential to be aware of how economic empowerment of women can lead to their social empowerment, which makes it doubly imperative to enable them to save. तो ये आपने एक बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट बात कही है रूपाली जी। तो आप जो अभी कह रही थी कि आप एक केस स्टडी बताना चाहेंगी, तो अगर आप उसके बारे में बता सके तो हम सुनना चाहेंगे, प्लीज प्लीज बताइए जी।
यस यस सर। हाँ, जैसे कि हम अभी सेविंग के बारे में बात कर रहे थे, और मैं ऐसे ही जब हमें डिजिटल बस लेकर एक गांव में पानवन करके यहाँ से मसवड़ मानदेसी के नजदीक से एक 15-20 किलोमीटर दूरी पर हमारा एक पानवन करके एक गांव है और वहाँ की एक ऐसी महिला है कि मैं आपकी केस स्टडी आपसे शेयर करना चाहती हूँ। हेमा नरड़े उस महिला का नाम है। वो एजुकेटेड भी है, ऐसा नहीं कि उसका एजुकेशन नहीं है सर, वो 10th तक पढ़ी लिखी भी है, उसे इंग्लिश आता है और वो खेती करती है। तो ये महिला, हम उनके पास गए, एटीएम का उनको ट्रेनिंग दे दिया था। उन्होंने कह दिया कि मैम हम, मेरे पास तो मेरा खुद का खाता भी नहीं है, तो मैं एटीएम का ट्रेनिंग लेके क्या करूं। तो हम भी सोचने लगे कि अरे इनके पास खाता नहीं, तो इनको हमारा फर्स्ट काम है तो इनको अकाउंट ओपन करके देना चाहिए। तो हमारा जैसे कि मानदेशी बैंक भी है हमारा, और हम मानदेशी बैंक ने हमें इतनी अथॉरिटी दे दी है कि जो महिला हमारे पास बैंक का खाता खोलने के लिए आ नहीं सकती, उनका खाता हम उनके घर पर जाकर उनका जो फॉर्म वगैरह है वो भरकर हम उनका खाता खोल कर देते हैं और एटीएम भी उनके घर पर जाकर उनको दे देते हैं। तो हमने उनका खाता पहले खुलवा दिया, एटीएम उनको घर पर जाकर दे दिया, एटीएम सीख गई वो, और उन्हें बैंक भी पता नहीं थी। जो हेमा नरड़े करके ये महिला है सर, उन्हें बैंक पता नहीं थी क्योंकि उस उनके घर का घर में ऐसी महिला बहुत सारी है कि उनको फ्रीडम नहीं मिलता है। जैसे कि 20 किलोमीटर वो ट्रेवलिंग करके शहर में आ जाए और बैंक में आ जाए, बैंक में अपना खाता खोले या और कुछ काम करे, ऐसा फ्रीडम नहीं होता क्योंकि उनके घर के सब काम उनके जेंट्स करते हैं। तो ये बहुत बड़ी हमारे लिए चैलेंज होता है कि उनको, महिलाओं को फ्रीडम नहीं होता। तो हमने फर्स्ट टाइम उनको एटीएम वहां उनके घर पर जाकर दिया, ये उनका खाता खोलकर हमारी मानदेशी बैंक में। तो उनको बहुत अच्छा लगा, वो थोड़ा बहुत सेविंग करने लगी। फर्स्ट टाइम तो वो 100 रुपीज से उन्होंने शुरू कर दिया सेविंग करना। 6 महीने ऐसे ही वो सेविंग करते रह गई, जितना भी उनके पास पैसा आता वो सेविंग करती थी, अपना जो खेती में काम करती थी उन्हें भी बहुत अच्छा लगता था, आज मेरा इतना हो गया, इतने मंथ इतना हो गया, वो ऐसे काउंट करती थी। और एक दिन उसके ऊपर एक ऐसी संकट आ गया उसके ऊपर कि उनका बच्चा है छोटा, वो बीमार हो गया और रात का टाइम था तो वो बैंक से पैसे भी निकाल नहीं सकती थी क्योंकि कोई भी बैंक रात को तो नहीं चालू रहता है ना। तो उसको एटीएम, उस महिला को, हेमा नरड़े को, हमने एटीएम का भी ट्रेनिंग दे दिया था और वो एटीएम भी यूज करती थी। तो रात के समय उनके पास जो भी सेविंग थी, जो भी उनके पास एक 4-5 हज़ार सेविंग हो गया था, वो सेविंग उन्होंने रात के समय एटीएम से निकालकर अपने बच्चे का इलाज कर दिया। तो उस महिला के दिमाग में इतनी बड़ी बात आ गई कि जो मैंने अभी तक कभी नहीं सेविंग की थी, जो आज मेरे जरूरत के लिए वो सेविंग मेरे जरूरत के लिए मुझे फायदे में आ गई और मैंने मेरे बच्चे का इलाज कर दिया और वो भी रात के समय एटीएम से निकालकर। और ये मैंने सीखा मानदेसी के वजह से, मैंने सीखा और ये मेरी जरूरत है कि मैं और भी सेविंग करूं और भी महिलाओं को मैं बता दूं कि सेविंग कितनी इम्पोर्टेंट है। ये उसने ठान लिया कि ये बहुत बड़ी बात है। तो वो ज्यादा सेविंग करने लगी, ज्यादा सेविंग करके उस महिला ने अभी गोट गोट का 4 गोट ले लिया और उनका सेली पालन भी वो कर रही है। बाद में उसने अपनी खेती, जैसे वो बाहर निकल, आप मैं थोड़ा सा ये फोकस करना चाहूंगी कि जो महिला घर से बाहर निकल जाती है तो उन्होंने उनको बहुत सारे ऐसे आइडिया आ जाती है कि वो खेती करती थी, पहले खेती वो सिंपल तरीके से करती थी लेकिन अब वो खेती करती है तो वो जैसे कि मर्चेंट पेपर डालकर वगैरह ऐसा आधुनिक पद्धति के तरीके से वो खेती करती है। तो ये बदलाव उसमें आ गया क्योंकि वो बाहर निकल आई, पहले तो वो घर से बाहर ही नहीं थी तो उसमें एक उतने पता भी नहीं था, वो बैंक क्या है, अकाउंट क्या है, सेविंग क्या है, ये सब कुछ पता भी नहीं था। लेकिन ये सब कुछ हो जाने के बाद, मानदेसी से जुड़ जाने के बाद उनके उनको एक पूरी तरह से समझ में आ गई। लेकिन बाद में उन्होंने कॉल करके हमको बता दिया कि मैम मुझे और आगे सीखना है, जैसे कि आपने एटीएम तो सिखा लिया मुझे बहुत बड़ा फायदा हो गया, मुझे सेविंग सिखा दी मुझे बहुत बड़ा फायदा हो गया, अभी मैं और भी कुछ सीखना चाहती हूँ, जैसे कि वो डिजिटल पेमेंट कैसे करना है, गूगल पे वगैरह वो भी उनको सिखा दे दिया। सर उनको मोबाइल भी चलाना नहीं आता था, स्मार्टफोन तो दूर की बात है, फीचर फोन भी चलाना नहीं आता था क्योंकि हाथ में हम भले हमारा एजुकेशन हो लेकिन हाथ में हमारे कोई चीज नहीं होती तो हमें नहीं वो आग नहीं चलानी आती, लेकिन अब वो महिला इतनी अच्छी तरह से मोबाइल चला लेती, ऑनलाइन शॉपिंग करती है, ऑनलाइन सब कुछ करती है, और बाजू की आजू बाजू की सारी महिलाओं को वो बचत क्यों करना है, सेविंग कैसे करना है, ये सब कुछ वो बता देती है। और बहुत अच्छी तरह से उन्होंने अपने बिजनेस में अभी सेविंग करके वो उसने एक टेलरिंग की मशीन भी खरीद ली है, और YouTube भी जाकर वो टेलरिंग के जैसे ब्लाउज कैसे सीना है, ड्रेस कैसे सीना है, ये सब कुछ भी देख लेती है, और वो अपना बिजनेस धीरे धीरे करके बढ़ा लेती है। खेती भी आधुनिक पद्धति से करती है, उनके गोट का भी अभी बिजनेस शुरू हो गया है, लेकिन ये हमारे लिए बहुत छोटा सा बदलाव हमें दिखाई देता है, लेकिन उसकी नजरिए से हम देखेंगे, हेमा नरे के नजरिए से देखेंगे तो वो बताते कि मैम मैं पहले ऐसी थी और मैं अभी इतना बड़ा मुझमें बदलाव आ गया है, हम उनकी नजरिए से देखते हैं तो ये बहुत बड़ी अच्छी बात लगती है हमें कि महिला कुछ करना चाहती है, घर से बाहर निकलना चाहती है, सेविंग करना चाहती है, अपना बैंक खाता खोलना चाहती है, तो उनको ये सारा फ्रीडम मिलना चाहिए, किसी को उनको पुश करना चाहिए, जैसे कि मानदेशी की हमारे डिजिटल प्रोजेक्ट के थ्रू हम उनको इतना अच्छा हमने उनको ट्रेन किया है और वो इतनी अच्छी अभी ट्रेन हो गई है, तो उस गांव की सारी महिला उनसे अभी सीखती है, महिला ही क्या वो जेंट्स को भी सिखाती है। तो और इससे अलावा मैं एक बात और कहना चाहूंगी सर कि उस महिला में ये सब तो बदला आ जाता है, उनका फाइनेंशियल कंडीशन हो वो बदल जाती है, उनका जैसे कि वो ऑनलाइन वगैरह सब कुछ कर लेती है, लेकिन उसका जो सेल्फ कॉन्फिडेंस है वो इतना बढ़ जाता है कि वो देखकर हमें बहुत खुशी हो जाती है, हमें अच्छा लगता है ना, किसी का सेल्फ कॉन्फिडेंस बढ़ाना इतनी बहुत बड़ी बात होती है, वो ईजी नहीं है, तो एक साल तक हमें उनके टच में रहना पड़ता है, तो वो हमारे हिसाब से हम ये देखते हैं कि वो हमारा इतना अच्छा इम्पैक्ट है कि उसका सेल्फ कॉन्फिडेंस बढ़ गया हमारी जी।
Got it. Thank you very much. And I think that really drives home the point that I mentioned earlier, that how economic empowerment and making sure that women are able to save also leads to their social empowerment. And it speaks to what Mr. Dwivedi said earlier. I mean, he spoke about awareness and about holding and operating an account. But there is probably also an element of behavior change here. And we will come to that eventually, how this behavior change can be effected and who is the right person to do it, which is the right entity to actually make sure that this behavior change happens. But before we talk about that, I would like to come to you, Mr. Joby. And if you could talk a little bit about the wealth management approach that Dwara adopts and how it is relevant to women microsavers, that will be great.
Yeah, so thank you very much, Amar and Access Assist, for inviting us for this session, and very proud to share the panel with fellow panelists. And can't agree more with Rubali Madam. Very relevant topics. She came up with the whole women empowerment and social empowerment ideas. I talk a little bit about Dwara KGFS wealth management approach. Dwara KGFS is a financial inclusion provider in the remote rural areas. We believe in a bit of financial well-being for rural households and enterprises. And we follow a wealth management approach in driving that financial well-being, following a particular methodology of plan, grow, protect, and diversify. So that's how we curate the wealth management approach for rural households. An idea of wealth management pretty much associated with the wealth and rich. 13 years back, when we wanted to kind of pursue this for the remote rural households, this was in kind of really welcomed much. But our thought process was the rural households with little resource need a kind of a very systematic wealth management approach, because their resources are very less. Unless that's planned in a very systematic way, you would not end up creating more wealth by following a kind of a financial journey. You know, there is an emphasis for over indebtedness or kind of over borrowing for all your financial problems. And our belief is that too much loans are not the solutions for all problems for the rural households. there may be insurances, like a lot of their problems, maybe the right answer is kind of proper insurance, systematic savings, having a kitty built for yourself rather than just rushing for an emergency loan at very non-efficient rates and terms that is not kind of comfortable for you. And maybe you may need to kind of end up selling, you know, kind of distressed sale of your little assets. So therefore, we believed in a kind of a wealth management approach. So Dwara believed in creating set of wealth managers across rural households. So we right now we had about more than 1,000 plus wealth managers who go to each village, sit with each household, enroll every household. We have got more than 1.3 million households enrolled with their total household income, expenditure, assets and liabilities, and their set of life goals. What are their goals for future? And then come up with a financial well-being report for that household. We call it as, you know, FWR, financial well-being report, and use that for charting out a journey for them. How can you achieve your goals in the time frame that you want? Most of the time, these goals are around children education, girl child marriage, having an own house at some point in time, or increasing their livestock, or in having a better land parcel. These are the kind of the goals that they've come up with. And we saw this journey was not very sustainable because we had invested in training wealth managers to be a trusted wealth advisor to the households. The problem with human beings trained is that attrition, people leave, and you can't, you know, kind of keep on building that and give the repeated experience of a trusted advisor. So a year and a half back, almost 2 years back, we collaborated with the Robert Bosch Center in Madras IIT, used the new age MI, you know, MLAI technologies to kind of come up with a recommendation engine by learning almost more than a million households data for more than 13 years. What are their aspirations? What is the prototype of these households? And we could draw similarities across many households in similar geographies. And then there is an algorithm built around as a recommendation engine. So we could remove the whole personal advisor, you know, limitations for scale and still offer high and, you know, kind of recommendations to sort of these customers. And our belief was that, you know, where we come from, a kind of a larger canvas of a country with 132 crore, you know, people with 25 to 30 crore households. And if we think about maybe 50 to 60 crore adults for seeking a job, the formal market is about, you know, what the PF data tells is about something like 5.5 crore Indians only have a PF account. There is about 4.895 crore Indians file income tax returns, and large majority of them are, you know, salaried class. So the self-employed income tax paying customer, I mean, citizens plus the PF account holders, to me, kind of maybe 15-20% of Indians are in the formal market. Having a formal income proof with a salary certificate or an income tax return. So a large number of Indians are in the informal market. The nature of their income is, you know, the opposite of the formal class, where the income is very certain, it is regular, and it's predictable, right? I mean, our salaries comes on pretty much certain and predictable. But a vast majority of Indians' income nature is unpredictable, uncertain, and it's irregular. You know, they don't come in the same fashion. So how to design right kind of, you know, savings products for this segment needs a lot of insights from the market. I mean, you can't just cut, copy, paste what's working with the formal market. Will not work for them. So we came up with a Dwara, some customers, you know, and we built a bit of habits that customers have built with the loan market. The microfinance companies have been successful in building customers every month or weekly or fortnightly, they understand EMI concept now. They come up with, and that habit has been built. So we want to borrow that habit into the savings habit. And then we suggest a way that you pay the same amount every month. Can you think about savings every month? And my recommendation engine allocates that money into various asset classes. And then we ran, you know, what are the asset classes they have confidence? Most of the rural folks tend to believe in gold. That's something a stable, you know, market they understand. They don't understand equities. They understand fixed deposits. The whole concept of wealth itself is very different in rural context. We ran surveys and, you know, and our urban construct of wealth is kind of equity, you know, money in the bank account and, you know, stuff like that. The way the rural households count wealth is that number of chicken, number of cows that they have, number of goats, you know, kind of maybe liters of milk. I know I was kind of having 10 liters of milk when I started this. Now I'm pouring, you know, 30 liters. So the whole concept of wealth in their mind is very different. And how can we associate with them into kind of build assets was kind of really our approach. And I would say we've been largely successful in kind of selling this idea of regular systematic subscription model of pay 250 rupees, 500 rupees, and then we help you to kind of meet your life goals. And savings has to be, you know, what we see is that if it is emotionally attached with a purpose, then the motivation to save becomes a lot more easier. You know, generally to save some 500 rupees, nobody is motivated. And we think that we will see later, right? I mean, when something happens, we will do about it. But if you say you are going to save for your children's education, which is a certain event that will come at a certain point in time, or you are going to think about your child's age, you know, marriage or constructing a house. So there is, then this whole motivation comes as, you know, kind of, so there is a lot of that whole emotional attachment of a purpose for saving. So this is kind of largely, you know, kind of we've introduced this. We have roughly about 30,000 odd regular savers, amounts ranging between 250 rupees to as high as 5,000 rupees per month. So there's lots of interesting, you know, kind of journeys that we have come through even during the pandemic period. Akshay Tritiya, people want to kind of invest in gold. So maybe I'll share some of those, you know, kind of insights as we kind of go, if time permits. So this is at a kind of a high level, I want to kind of share what we follow.
Got it. Thanks for that. I do have a follow-up question for you. But before I ask that, I would like to come to Mr. Shekhawat, and we would love to hear from you the perspectives of an SFB, having the networks and the ability to reach this segment. What role do you see for SFBs in encouraging micro savings and micro investments by women specifically?
You are muted.
Yeah, I think you're on mute.
Thank you, Amol. You know, very nice. It was great listening to Rupali ji, you know, Satyajit ji and Jovi. So, you know, very interesting topic when we talk about. So this topic talks about three separate areas. One is the digital financial services, right? So there is a section where what we are discussing today talks about digital financial services. Then we talk about which is more relevant to the low income women of India. And the importance of women in India, like Satyajit ji spoke about that, you know, we will have approximately 400 million, you know, workforce of women by 2030. And that is where the differentiation is, that how do we channelize that to the formal economy in terms of the entire generation of wealth which is happening there. And when we talk about what percentage of people are using accounts and those statistics comes into the picture. So very relevant that we talk about women, that what is the financial services and technology available. Largely, you know, relating to micro savings and micro investing. So all of this, when you talk about a bank and when I was listening to all of you, you know, it becomes so relevant because bank is one platform. Which allows you to do everything which is covered under this topic, right? Because the financial services, the digitization, talking about the women-based products, talking about the micro-savings, micro-investing, everything is something which the bank platform allows you to do. And specifically, you know, this SFB category of banks, which, you know, came up since the licensing in 2014, you know, various parts of the geography, we as SFB have been able to do a great job in terms of bringing, you know, the core markets, which we call in AU, which is the rural semi-urban markets. And we call them core because they are the markets where we have built our larger, you know, models. So I think for every SFB, the core markets are the key, and they have done a great effort in terms of bringing them closer to the economy. But I'll just touch base upon why banks are relevant, why SFBs are relevant, and then what SFBs are doing or what AU is doing from that perspective. A few very interesting thoughts and stuff which is happening in banking from a technology perspective, which Rupaliji, I think, will be very interested in or Jovi. You know, when I talk about savings, largely when we are talking about the rural women, you know, piece like in AU, when I talk about, I've got approximately 35,000 women customers who are borrowers, right? And like our MD was just talking about in a session prior to this, that, you know, when you talk about a low income women group, please understand wealth creation itself is the wrong word for them, because that wealth is a subject. Comes up later. It's more about insurance investment. It's about saving, right? So that wealth is the second level of subjectivity, but with the kind of income levels they have, if they, you know, invest it somewhere also, they'll not be able to generate great returns, because what they will get maximum is 5%, 6%, 7%, right? But on a monthly saving of 500 rupees, a 5% is not going to create wealth, right, in their lifetime. So largely, unko kabil banana, right? And Rupali ji was talking about that, that how do we instill, you know, skills, how do we build them entrepreneurs, and how do we make them, and that is where the concept of SFBs also plays a larger role, that you lend them to generate income, right? You lend them to do business, or you create or support them, like AU runs a program from our CSR activity called as AU Udyogini, where we reach out to these women in the various parts of our core geographies and train them to start their own business setups, you know, whether it is a masala, you know, making factory, or whether it is a flour making factory and stuff like that. But, and I'm sure every bank is doing a lot of stuff around that, but how do we empower them to generate more income? And then comes that investing in micro savings, which leads to overall wealth creation of a low income, you know, women group. And now, when I talk to you, a lot of it will be also related to my childhood experiences throughout the various small villages of Rajasthan. And, you know, savings as a habit, you know, when we talk talking about that, we need to instill a habit of saving. But I slightly disagree there, because, you know, as an Indian tradition, savings has always been a habit of the women in India. Right, whether it was our grandmothers, or whether it was our, you know, grandparents, or whether you see it today also in the most illiterate community or the part of India, you will still find that saving is a habit of women in India, because it's part of a tradition. And very interestingly, what Jobi was correlating to a goal-based saving, that when you correlate a goal to a saving, it becomes very emotionally connected. If you go back when we were born, and you know, at the time around 80s, you know, when I was born in 80s. You know, my grandmother, or, you know, I have seen women in villages used to save every day from the household expenses which have been provided to them, though the larger part of that savings was part of cash. Okay. So that saving was done for an objective, for a purpose. Ki meri beti aayegi na, to main usko do jodi kapde banwa ke dungi, to main uske liye bacha. Main, you know, I'm, ab ye Purnima aane wali hai, to us Purnima pe mujhe प्रसाद करवाना है, तो मैं उसके लिए सेव कर लूं, यू नो, फॉर गॉड, फॉर योर डॉटर, फॉर योर सन्स, यू नो, बेटर क्लोथ्स फॉर अ वेडिंग, और व्हेन यू हैव टू गेट अ पर्टिकुलर ज्वेलरी पीस मेड ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम. द वुमेन हैव ऑलवेज बीन सेविंग इन आवर कंट्री, एंड थैंकफुली आई एम वेरी प्राउड ऑफ दैट वी स्टिल कंटिन्यू विद दैट ट्रेडिशन, यू नो, वेदर इन अर्बन मार्केट्स और इन रूरल मार्केट्स. द चैलेंज, यू नो, एंड दैट इज वेयर आई थिंक सत्यजीत जी टच्ड अपॉन, इज दैट the awareness, you know, how do we bring it to the formal part of the economy, right? So it is today in cash, or it is today in kind. Like, for example, in urban markets, a very interesting concept is kitty. you know, which I as a banker, you know, I keep telling my mother and my wife about it. Yeah, practically you are not earning less interest on it. You know, you don't understand that when you are playing this kitty game in your families and friends, no. So, but wo kitty kya hai? It is a micro saving, right? They all put together a certain amount of money, and then one person gets that money, and that person buys or ensures that his or her goal is met through that kitty, right? Now, practically it's a RD. Practically it's a recurring deposit product. Because every month you are particularly adding, and one, if there are 12 members in a kitty, on the 12th month you'll get a bounty, right? So the products have existed. How do you channelize them into a formal economy through digital services? Yes, that is very, very, very critical. When Amar said that how do you think that banks can play a role or SFBs? I think since Demon and when we started, when the government used the banks as a channel to distribute PMJDY accounts, and after that all the social security accounts, whether it was PMJGY or Pradhan Mantri Jeevan Jyoti Bima Yojana, or we are talking about APY, which is Atal Pension Yojana today, all this has emphasized and come up very clearly for banks that banks are the only network today in country which reach out to the last common denominator, and which has a power to revolutionize a particular thought. You know, we all can do small things in our respective domains, but if you have to make a national campaign, if you have to revolutionize the overall concept, then you can only do it by channelizing it through banks. And that banks have proven in the last few years, time and again, whether it was this COVID time or whether it was Demon or whether it has been the distribution of social security schemes. Now, and today, you know, I'm sure not only SFBs, but any other bank, and this is with AU also, a large part of their saving books comes from housewives, from urban markets. Like, urban markets obviously give you a large part of liability, and core markets will give you a smaller liability, but larger base. But you will have a book which is stable in terms of savings deposits. You will have a book which continues to grow without having any fluctuations, and which will be large part of the book will always come from a housewife segment. Now, one point is that how do you as a bank empower these housewives to ensure that they become social entrepreneurs and they start generating income, which I think SFBs and specifically people places like AU, we have been doing phenomenally good work on that area by lending to them. And ensuring, and I think SFBs have done a great job, whether it has been microfinance-led lending or whether it has been NBFC-led lending like banks like AU, where we have created opportunities of employment and generation of income. But at the same time, the another specific change is that how do we, product, like one angle Jobi was talking about, that how do you ensure that product is more relevant to that job or product is more relevant to such people? Now, you don't have to do things which are very dramatic, right? Because end of the day, those people are saving. You need to channelize it. Like post office savings, and I have seen great examples in my personal life where schemes of NSC, schemes of KVPs, Kisan Vikas Patras, there were government schemes which are about the girl child benefits in various state governments. They have played a key role in terms of rural women when they were saving in piecemeals for their kids, right? And I think like post office has a last mile connectivity, and similarly, on one end, RBI, our regulator has done a great job that in last few years, they have mandated banks to reach out to unbanked areas, whether by a mode of a BO or a BC. And the reach of banks to almost every village in the country, I think, is almost there. Or, we'll be in next 2 years, we'll be almost there in terms of the most unbanked areas of the country also. So a bank is available, whether it is in a mode of a BO, a banking correspondent, but there is a unit which will allow you to do banking services in the respective geography. Now, the concept is that how do you make, the women aware that what are the products which they can use, how you can train them, which I think Rupali ji is doing a brilliant job and her organization. But I think SFBs, with the benefit of technology, have done a lot of good on that side also. And I think the smartphone penetration has helped us a lot on that subject, because the more and more people have started using WhatsApp, video calling. I think video calling is one of the brilliant things which could have happened to Indian banking industry, which we will see in coming time, because during this COVID, we realized that because we had to stop the physical communication, and video banking is something which AU personally believes has come up one of the greatest opportunities to engage with customers and to empower them and train them in terms of the financial literacy. I'll just take one more minute and explain that we have been doing a great amount of effort on the financial literacy side as AU. We picked up Nukkad Natak's, in respective geographies. If it's Maharashtra, then Marathi Nukkad Natak company. If it's Gujarat, then Gujarati Nukkad Natak company. Rajasthan Nukkad Natak company. And they were going to village by village and conducting Nukkad Natak's to train them on security and safety. Because today in banking, or for the women, please understand, sabse important kya hai, convenience, ki aasani kya hai. Second, the security and safety is something which is building the trust. Wo pehle hi wahan pe, resources scarce hai. Agar wahan pe security deficit ho gaya, ya trust deficit create ho gaya, then that person will never bank. And with the increasing digital frauds, it's very important that convenience and security builds together to ensure that there is a right amount of technology or a digital financial services gets built up. So, usme na Nukkad Natak karke we were trying to explain that CVV kya hai, security pin kya hai, UPI ka security pin kya hai, so that you are able to safeguard your account, right? But then we realized that this video banking, and these last 9 months, and this is one area where AU is investing big time, because we realized that this is one mode where you can, efficiently increase, by increasing the efficiency, you can engage with the rural women or the urban women or the various parts of the country without having being a, wasting resources, and do a lot on the financial literacy as well as onboarding the customer to digital platforms in terms of day-to-day use. Eventually, because with the penetration of mobile and today with the technology enabling the banks to provide everything in the mobile, right? Because practically a mobile is a bank. Your bank is on your fingertips. You can do everything what you do with a bank on your mobile today. And if it gets enabled with video banking, where the person is able to interface with the banker on his mobile, like he's doing a video call, and he can understand all the schemes, he can invest, he can save, then that can build a real future in terms of the digital financial services for this sector. But sky's the limit, and I think this area's revolution lies in hands of banks larger than, and obviously the every part of the country and all institutions have to work together, but with the emphasis of regulator RBI, with the emphasis of Government of India, with the schemes which Government of India has brought in for a lot of people in last couple of years, where the benefit schemes are high, and all these things put together is going to change the face of the rural banking, and specifically the banking for women in India. And I think the remaining points we can cover up, and the questions are going to come up, because I think I have taken a lot of time for yours.
Sure, thanks for that. Thanks for that. And I think you mentioned a couple of things that are very relevant and very interesting. You did mention how the savings habit already exists.
Yeah.
And it is how we make it more formal or more institutional. And that really is the crux of this discussion. You also mentioned about convenience, trust, security, and scalability, which I think is very important. And I would like to go back to Mr. Jobi on that. You also referred to scalability when you spoke about how once you were able to remove the personal advisors, that gave you the ability to reach more people. Having said that, and this is a question for you, Mr. Shekhawat, as well, is that there is anecdotal evidence that women feel more comfortable when they are interfacing with a woman banker. So how do you how do you play the role of making sure that you have technology to enable scalability, but at the same time you have that personal touch that will make it really meaningful for those women? And I believe the work that Rupali Madam has been doing is that, right? She is the face of the organization. There is a trust there, and she is from the community, and that is one of her key strengths that has allowed her to reach so many women and really cause a change. So, Mr. Jobi, any thoughts on that? Removing of the personal advisors, is it a double-edged sword?
Yeah, no, so very interesting point. Like, our sense is that in the rural context, it's kind of both high touch and high tech is the whole combination works. There's lots of things. Technology is the best thing to solve, right? When it comes to advice, maybe, you know, there are tools now to kind of build recommendation engine and stuff like that. But if you want one person to stand in front of the household, you can't replace that with technology, right? I mean, you need that person. But the advice, instead of he tells with his own personal experience, the system can show you a couple of dashboards, you know, kind of go and choose. So banking is all about trust building. So the way that we have gone about is that in the remote rural areas, we saw there is kind of lack of infrastructure. For our own assessment is that why a lot of the informal savings, as Shekhawat was saying, is not coming into the formal world is lack of right kind of institutions and right instruments that actually, you know, kind of captures the, you know, kind of the wealth concept of these customers. So we invested in kind of rural branches, which are, you know, kind of branded in similar color and all of that. And, you know, kind of you have wealth managers in uniform and, you know, kind of, so all this, and they kind of keep coming to, as Rubali madam was saying, that they go to the household, you know, they don't come to the branch. So there is this whole everything that's kind of built. Giving loan is easy. That even if they don't trust you, they will take money from you because you know, kind of they have nothing to lose, because if you don't turn up, they are kind of not going to pay. But for if you want to get any penny from them, the story is different. So the way that we have gone about is that we take more risk with them. Like most of them get a loan from us. So they know that we are always long with them in terms of higher exposure, and then asking them to kind of save, it becomes more credible for them, right? And you know, and secondly, the whole infrastructure and the, you know, the systems that we have created kind of helps to kind of build that trust. And the way that we think as we kind of go forward, a lot of transaction can move into a bit of an assisted mode using technology, the way is kind of maybe using lots of banking correspondent agent model, which are all powered with, I mean, as you know, Shekhawat was saying, a mobile is the bank today, right? I mean, every and you need to have the, you know, the touch points in the proximity, you know, where they can go. Not everybody have a bit of an assisted mode. And there's such use, if you are in it, you can bundle back and forth, you can.
I think we are losing you a little bit, Mr. Jovi. So I'll just, you know.
Yeah, is it audible now?
Yes, this is much better.
Right. So I was saying that, you know, kind of with this whole digital empowerment that's happening, and the COVID has kind of really fast-paced that whole digitization efforts across all institutions, and that gives us a kind of a capability for every household to access everything, no matter you are rural, urban, you are poor, rich. You know, the whole unit economics have really changed in terms of whether you save X amount or in Y amount and all that. There is kind of a minimum viable product today that could be offered to every household to kind of meet their objectives. And to me, the way to kind of really go forward is, you know, the local trust is built through a bit of a very high touch approach, and the high tech really used in your product innovation, delivery mechanisms, channels, agent touch points, banking correspondence. Right kind of products with very interesting, you know, kind of product manufacturers, whether are mutual funds, insurance companies, pension products, small finance banks are rightly oriented towards this segment. They understand these customers really well. So this, you know, I see it's kind of a world of partnerships, you know, kind of it's the kind of the someone has an access at the last mile. It's a lot more economical to kind of work with that last mile operator and bundle lots of products which are, you know, kind of meant for the empowerment of that household and especially women.
Got it. Thanks for that. Yeah, so I agree that the high touch plus the high tech is probably the way to go. And I'll just take a pause here and mention that we are at time. So we have about 20 minutes to go. So I would request the audience to keep their questions coming. We already have started receiving a few questions. But one of the good things about this online format is that the questions can keep coming in while the panel is ongoing. So I encourage all of you to ask questions and I will take them up as they come to me. But this brings me to Mr. Dwivedi, and we have spoken about behavior change and how the high touch is probably required initially before the high tech follows to cause the behavior change. And as Mr. Jovi just said, it's a world of partnerships. So from your standpoint, from your vantage, how do you see the strategy of RBI and NABARD and NCFE has evolved to ensure that this behavior change can be effected? And who do you think takes the onus of effecting this behavior change? This is also one of the questions that we have gotten from the audience. I think you're on mute.
I said before, it's a good question. And before I answer that, let me appreciate the good work done by the Diwara, KGFS, AU Small Finance Bank and the Mandeshi, because one thing which is common from their presentation we all saw is it is just not the financial product, which has gone hand in hand with the financial product is the financial literacy and the education that they are doing. KGFS with their health, I mean, the wealth workers, 1,000 of them going into the villages and doing the household balance sheet, the Mandeshi, which is a model bank, and they have a foundation, which is the Mandeshi Foundation, which carries this financial literacy and education, which goes hand in hand with that. And AU Small Finance Bank is also doing their own with their customers and their clients. And so this, I mean, it's a very clear that this is a bundle of things which are going in this institution, which ultimately is good for the customers, it's good for the banks, and it will reflect on their balance sheet as well in terms of less NPAs. So that has been very increasingly realized that financial education is going to play a crucial role in ensuring, and when the financial inclusion efforts are going to grow in exponentially in the years to come. For that only, there are two strategy documents. One for the financial inclusion, which is a five-year strategy, 2019-24, prepared by the Reserve Bank of India. And the five-year strategy, 2020-25, is the financial literacy, which has been prepared by the NCFE, has been implemented. So if you see, look at the strategy. So as I mentioned, the knowledge, behavior, and the attitude. These are the three parameters which the financial education initiatives are trying to focus on these three parameters mainly. How do you bring about the changes in the financial behavior? How do they make the household prepare a financial budget? How do they make the household responsible for money management? These are the things which are built into the content part itself. So what is the financial national strategy for financial literacy is trying to achieve that? If you look at our strategy, it is based on the 5C approach. The first C is the content. That means the content has to be developed, standardized, but again, customized to the target group specific. We have a financial literacy content for adults, but then when we go to the women focus, then the same content is refocused and targeted to the women, target to the MSME. So target specific content development that we are ensuring. And we are also acutely aware that only the target specific content is not going to deliver. It has to be delivered in the plain, simple language in terms of which they understand. So those contents are being translated into regional languages. If you see our website, it is developed in 13 to 14 languages, NCFE website. Most of the materials are available in 13 to 14 languages. So that is another thing that we have done. At the content part also, I mean, the banks are doing their own job, but there are a lot of people outside the banking fold also who need financial education, like the school students who are yet to I mean, join the formal banking system. So that is one of the top priority agenda of the national education policy, as well as the for all the sector regulators, and NCFE is taking that forward. So we are in dialogue with the Minister of Education to integrate this financial education as part of the formal school curriculum. So from standard six onward, they study this as a part of curriculum. So that is ensured at the students' level. Then we go to the adults, and then the adults, we, the along with 5C, we have a 3D approach. So having touched that, the content is the first thing. Content has to be relatable contents. I mean, where the target audience can relate to the content. Then the delivery of the content could be various channel, as I think Jobiji or Shekhabuji was mentioning, Nukkad Natak, and all those are very brilliant, very effective mode of delivery of the financial literacy campaigns. So those are the things. This is one size fits all. It is true for financial education as well. So what at the national level we are trying to do, we are trying to develop the content for every section of the society, very, very target specific content in regional languages. And in the COVID situation, we realized that this content, more than this, we also need to have an e-content. So we have a dedicated website called Arthashiksha, where we have the 20 modules in the financial education, but NCFE being the sector agnostic, promoted by all the financial sector regulators, we are just not propagating only banking or only insurance or only. So we go in a holistic manner. All our contents you will find will have insurance, will have investment in the capital markets, will have banking, and will have the pension. So that e-shiksha, arthashiksha, the thing is based on that. The 5.5 hours of module, 20 modules, it speaks about everything. And whoever needs, if it is a SHG group, he can pick up a module and see what are the thing. But on their own, and this is also converted into an app. But of course, it is on the Moodle app, because we developed it on the Moodle. We are trying to make it a Play Store app soon. So content along with the app. So this is how that technology will be used in disseminating the financial literacy campaign across the country. More than that, I'll just tell you, in our own experience in NCFE, we would have conducted more than 4,000 programs during last 3-4 months, September to November, all on online mode. So we have the resource persons trained and certified by SEBI, and FLC trainers who are certified by Reserve Bank. So what is happening, the content is standardized, which is vetted and supported by the four sector regulators. So content is quality content. Then the delivery part, whoever is delivering is also trained and certified. It has to be either through SEBI or the Reserve Bank or the Pension Fund Regulation Authority or the IRDAI regulated. So both sides are this, but that not, I'm not saying that this is all. So we are always looking forward and trying to explore new partnership, new strategic partnership, including the small finance banks and the private institution, the industry body, all our stakeholders. And in the whole implementation, the good thing about this is that there are more than 12 to 13 central ministries are involved, those who are identified as the key stakeholders, and they are also contributing to the implementation of the financial literacy initiatives. So, for example, MORT. So what tremendous work they are doing when we are talking of health creation and all, they have that whole set of SHGs, and for whom they have the RCT to a national RCT institution. So they have standardized the training model. So there itself, again, the financial literacy model we are trying to integrate. So all these SHG members, which are millions of SHG members, are being trained in the financial literacy. That model that they are following is a multiple model. I mean, the multiplier effect. I train a master trainer, he goes and trains, and it's a community participation. We are drawing trainers from their own community. So participatory approach is another thing we have realized, and the Reserve Bank is also doing that through their CFL model, Center for Financial Literacy. They have in 100 blocks, and the Governor of Reserve Bank has said that by 2024 March, all the blocks in the country will be covered with the CFL approach, where it will be a participatory community involved delivery system. So the civil society, the NGOs will be involved in delivering this. So that part also we are aware. Then the capacity development, the capacity of the trainers, I said, those who are providing the financial education training, they need to be strengthened. So their capacity. So through the College of Agriculture Banking, through the Bankers Institute of Rural Development, we will be trying to train these trainers and build their capacity. The another thing is communication. I said ICT-based technology is essentially the one which will be used largely. We will be going to have a national level dashboard to capture the initiatives of different stakeholders in the financial literacy space. We are going to have an app. So we are going to have the e-content and the e-delivery. So in the communication part also, we have done, we have set up more than 100 interactive kiosks at strategic places where the people can go in the post offices, primary health centers, panchayat offices, and the digital signage places where the financial literacy messages are disseminated. Apart from that, also we upload the GIF files in our social media. We are on Twitter, we are on Facebook, and all these GIF files are uploaded. So then the fourth C is the collaboration. As I said, we are open to collaborate with anyone and everyone who shows interest. So we can, I mean, we have not fixed kind of a thing. Whoever comes with a project that, okay, they are doing this good work, we are open to collaboration, because we know that's how the whole efforts need to be scaled up, and NCFE alone cannot do. So partnership and collaboration is the main thing. So these are the five C that I said what we are doing. And the within the 5C, then we again focus based on the survey report, which I told, the gender differences, then the rural-urban divide, then the geographical differences, the east, central, and south, they are showing less penetration of the financial literacy compared to the west and north. So the focus will be more on there. We are targeting the northeast. We are targeting the 116, 17 aspirational districts that have been identified by NITI Aayog. So geography. Then the age group wise, I said, starting from catching them young in financial literacy when they are in standard six. We also have kids comics and kids material in our website where the kids can go and play games. We have also a section called how to. I would request you to go and visit our website, how to open an account, how to do the KYC. See, there's a whole lot of how to are there, where those kind of literacy, process literacy, I say, how to operate an ATM, that is the process literacy part. And then the geography I mentioned, then the target, whether they have farmers, the farmer producer organizations, or the MSME. So within this 5C, these are the three dimensions that we concentrate on. So this is how the whole strategy, and it is a 5-year strategy. And not only that, it has a evaluation and monitoring mechanism built into it, and it is evaluated and monitored at the highest level at the Financial Stability Development Council, FSDC, under which the technical group on the financial inclusion and literacy has been set up, which is headed by the deputy governor. So it is being monitored at that level. So there will be a 3 years evaluation concurrent at the end of operation and implementation of 3 years. At the end of 5 years, like this survey, another survey report in 2025, where we have progressed, how we have progressed, and what are the learnings that can be built into the policy perspective in the next thing. As it fade from the last 2018 survey, we have incorporated what works and what doesn't work. And those kind of things we have now incorporated in this implementation phase. So this is, I think, how we are going to go about the implementation. But we are sure that now the supply side, every branch has. Now, with the bank-led, ICT-led banking model, the BCs can open the account, BC can do the banking transaction. So the bank has reached every village. So the supply side, more than the supply side issues, the demand side constraints are more. So our products are existing. The insurance, 11 insurance products are existing. 2 beautiful pension products are there. The banking products are many. The regulators are very, very progressive now, allowing multiple players to come in and do the business in different financial sectors. So the whole ecosystem is now not only evolved, I would say that it is much evolved. There's nothing that you say something which is not there in our country. This is only the implementation. And I am sure with this 5 years again, we will have increased financial literacy and increased usage of the financial and products and the services.
Got it. Thanks for that. We had a related question actually come in earlier, which said that what is the role of a financial capability approach? And I think you have already answered that, where you have said that, there is a push to catch them young, and financial capability being built at various levels. So that so that at a young age, so that financial inclusion really is pushed. And you also spoke about collaboration and a participatory approach and how the demand side needs to be strengthened. So I would like to come to Rupali ji here again. Madam, jaise aapne suna, abhi hum scalability ki baat kar rahe the aur high touch plus high tech ki baat kar rahe the aur kaise aapke madhyam se jaise 6000 plus mahilaon ko aapne train kiya hai. तो ये जो डिमांड साइड की बात हो रही है कि कैसे और महिलाओं को इसमें फाइनेंशियल इंक्लूजन की तरफ और संगठित बचत की तरफ लाया जाए, तो अगर हमें 6000 से 6 लाख तक जाना है तो आप क्या बताएंगी, आपके लर्निंग्स क्या है, आप क्या मैसेज देना चाहेंगी सबको कि जो बेस्ट प्रैक्टिस फॉलो होनी चाहिए जिससे कि और महिलाएं जो कि रूरल एरिया में है वो फॉर्मल स्वरूप में बचत कर सकें.
यस सर, मैं अभी यहाँ पे एक मैंने सबका सबकी बात सुन ली और मुझे ऐसा लगता है कि जो रूरल एरिया है वहाँ की महिलाएं बचत तो करना चाहती है और वो जैसे शिकावत सर ने कहा कि वो इंडियन कल्चर ही ऐसा है कि महिलाएं पहले से ही बचत करती थी, जैसे कि वो डिब्बे में बैंक में नहीं हो तो थोड़ा बहुत डिब्बे में कहाँ पर भी ऐसा कुछ उनकी बेटी है बच्चे के पढ़ाई के लिए वो थोड़ा बहुत ऐसा अपना अपनी तरीके से बचत कर रही थी लेकिन वो बैंक में नहीं कर रही थी. ठीक है, तो ऐसी अभी हम 6000 महिलाओं के पास पहुंचे हैं तो हम 6 लाख आप बोल रहे हैं कि उन महिलाओं के पास कैसे पहुंच जाए, वो सेविंग के बारे में कैसे उनको बता दे और वो कैसे सेविंग के तरफ मुड़ जाए. तो बैंक जो हमारी बैंक होती है तो बैंक हर एक के पास तो नहीं पहुंच सकती है, जैसे कि बैंक का कोई स्टाफ हो या हर एक के पास तो नहीं पहुंच सकता है. तो हम ऐसा करेंगे कर सकते हैं क्या, जैसे कि हर एक छोटे छोटे विलेज हो तो उस विलेज में ऐसी महिलाओं के पास वो एक अथॉरिटी हम दे दी जाए, जैसे किराना शॉप चलाने वाली महिला है तो उनके पास वो बाकी सारी उसकी आजू बाजू की महिला सेविंग करे और उसका सेविंग का जो इम्पोर्टेंस है वो भी बता दे. तो ये हमारे लिए जैसे कि एक महिला है और वो 500 रुपीज या 100 रुपीज वो सेविंग करती है तो वो हमारे लिए एक महिला है, लेकिन जब 500 महिलाएं जब 100 रुपीज या 500 रुपीज सेविंग करेंगी तो उसका जो मॉप है वो बहुत बड़ा हो जाएगा. तो वैसे हम ज्यादातर ज्यादा महिलाओं के पास पहुंच जाएंगे और वो ज्यादा महिला हर महिला सेविंग करना चाहती है तो हम हर महिला को महिला सेविंग करेगी तो उनके पास हम ज्यादा से ज्यादा पहुंच जाएंगे और सेविंग का जो हम जैसे कि 6000 से 6 लाख ये टारगेट देख रहे हैं तो वो हो जाएगा. अमर जी.
Okay. So thanks for that. So I think collaboration is the key here. And while all of this was going on, there is one question that was asked to the audience is how many account holders have availed the 5,000 rupees overdraft facility that the Janadhan Yojana provides? And more than 85% people responded that fewer than 10% have availed that facility, and that's actually correct. And I believe the number is actually closer to 1%. And the reason for that is that although there are these so many Jandan accounts, they are just inoperative and nobody really operates them. And the overdraft facility requires a certain level of activity before it can be operationalized. So that kind of drives home the point about how just opening these accounts is not enough. There needs to be a high touch accompanied with the high tech to ensure that they are actually being used. And financial inclusion is substantively achieved. So I think we are almost at time. We have only a couple of minutes to go. So what I would like to do is I would just request Mr. Jobi and Mr. Shekhawat say a few closing words from the discussion right now. How do you see the path forward? How do you see the high touch?
Something very interesting when Abhi Rupali ji baat kar rahe the na. It's very interesting, and I think that can be one of the most important things when we close is that, and this is based on my interactions with a lot of women, working women, not even women in rural segment. Ek kya hai, Rupali ji, har aadmi ka ye manna hai ki jo hamare gaon ki women hai, wohi financially illiterate hai. Sabko kya lagta hai ki jo rural area mein log hain, wohi financially illiterate hai, wohi dhang se financial products ko nahi samajh paate. But main aapko And Satyajit ji, you'll be very surprised that in Bombay also, when on Women's Day functions I have conducted in large organizations, large corporate organizations, and और आप ये सब अपने घर में भी ट्राई कर सकते हैं. मैं जब एक क्वेश्चन वहां पे पूछता था कि आप बताइए आप में से कितनी महिलाएं हैं जो कि खुद अपनी इनकम टैक्स रिटर्न भरती हैं, यू विल बी सरप्राइज दैट देयर वाज नॉट मोर देन 5-10% इन एनी फोरम आई हैव मेट. 200 लोग, 300 लोग, बड़े बड़े कॉर्पोरेट इंस्टीट्यूशन में, बॉम्बे, दिल्ली, जयपुर, बड़े बड़े शहरों के अंदर. अब जब जब मैंने कहा आपकी फाइनेंशियल रिटर्न कौन भरता है, तो बोले हस्बैंड भरते हैं. आपके फाइनेंसेस कौन मैनेज करता है, आप कमा रहे हो, आप पढ़े लिखे हो, राइट? आप रूरल एरिया के यू नो दैट जो हम टिपिकल डिस्कशन कर रहे हैं उसके बाहर हो, बट आप फाइनेंशियली लिटरेट नहीं हो. आप लिटरेट हो, आप एजुकेटेड हो, बट आप फाइनेंशियली लिटरेट नहीं हो. आप क्रेडिट कार्ड यूज कर पाते हो, बट जो जो भी जी बोलेंगे डू यू नो हाउ वेयर टू इन्वेस्ट, स्टिल दैट डिसीजन इज बीइंग टेकन बाय अ हस्बैंड, स्टिल दैट डिसीजन इज बीइंग टेकन बाय अ सन, स्टिल दैट डिसीजन इज बीइंग टेकन बाय अ फादर, राइट? Now, that जिस दिन you know एक right approach bank की जो कि है inclusive approach की जो हम बात कर रहे हैं rural plus as well as urban markets के अंदर, you know, and with all this education we need to bring in a comprehensive segment where, because women has to play a very important role in the economy, right? And that is where the everyday the game is changing. And you know, I can tell you, I'm just you know, always at my home. If you tell me that I'm in minority, women are in majority, you know, between my mother, wife, my daughter, and you know, maids, so I'm the only one male around. But the fact is, I understand that if all of them get empowered, like for example, aap apni maid ko bhi salary dete ho na sir, aur main ek banker ki nazar se bol raha hu, aap sab log apne ghar mein kisi ko salary dete ho to aap unke account mein do, unko cash mat do. Aapne jaise abhi bola na amar ki जनधन अकाउंट खुल गया, बट वो अकाउंट यूज नहीं हो रहा. उसका एक रीजन ये भी है कि हम भी बहुत कंफर्टेबली उसको कैश दे देते हैं. दैट पर्सन हैज अकाउंट, यू आस्क देम, यू हैव अकाउंट, इफ यू डोंट हैव इट प्लीज ओपन अकाउंट, मैं आपको सैलरी आपके बैंक अकाउंट में देता हूँ, आप बैंक अकाउंट यूज करो. यू नो द इंस्टीट्यूशंस विल प्ले देयर रोल, बट एवरीबॉडी, ईच वन ऑफ अस, इफ वी प्ले अ रोल, कैन वी टीच आवर मदर्स एंड यू नो वाइव्स एंड सिस्टर्स दैट हाउ यू शुड इन्वेस्ट, राइट? How you should become financially independent, how you should create a wealth for yourself. And that is the message which each one of us in India needs to proliferate to ensure that there is an inclusive financial growth for women in India. And like I said initially, ki dekho, still the majority of the savings deposit of the banks comes from housewives. That is going to grow each day. But the majority of those housewives accounts are today operated by a father or a husband or a son. The reality is that that needs to change, and that can only happen if we all the organizations join together and ensure that we play our role in terms of right kind of education, empowerment, generating employment, and helping women become self-empowered. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Mr. Jovi, from your side.
Yeah, no, so very nice the insights from Shekhawat. I was just thinking that in this whole current world, there is this whole influencers, right? People go after influencers to kind of do what the right thing. So we ran a survey with our customers, 99% women. Whom do they consult when they have to take a decision about a financial, you know, kind of products? We had very surprising, you know, kind of results from different states. Right. And many places, these women, elderly women, seem to trust their educated daughters. They call their elder ones and ask, you know, what is this thing? They inform their husbands, but they don't, you know, kind of don't seek permissions or approvals from sort of husbands. But their, you know, kind of educated if daughters are there. They are the ones. And one or two states, especially in Karnataka, we saw where the self-help groups are all, I mean, the group mechanism, the, you know, the JLG group. So they are very dominant there. So they seem to trust their group members. If they have to kind of decide on something, their trust factor is where with the same group. So I think when we design certain products, there is this whole concept about farmers, you know, the whole lead farmer concept, right? I mean, if you want to convert a village, you need to kind of find out one or two large farmer whom other farmers trust, no matter they think institutions all have vested interest, right? When you try to kind of do a savings product or anything, the trust factor would, whatever it be, if your intent also very good. I think this world is around the right kind of influencers, opinion makers, and if we can get them around with the right intent, you know, because it's all about another steps to kind of really build trust building with the kind of customers. So we believe is that kind of product designing is also critical for customers whose income patterns are very different. You know, kind of you can't have a regular. We were debating an RD product is a good for. Informal, because their income itself is not in regular pattern. Like you don't know a daily wage earner, how many days he has work. When he has money, he has no right instrument or right institution to kind of really lodge. Rightly Shagavat was saying, the problem is really cash. You know, it's not about converting. The efforts to convert cash into digital in the local economy, lot of efforts, and the incentives are not aligned for that kind of an effort. And if you can get away with cash in your normal world, it looks like a lot of artificial effort has been taken to get the money into the bank account. I'm not convinced about the benefits of reaching that money into the bank account for a lot of customers who we talk about. So that's something to kind of really think about. How can we capture a classic thing that I saw is that an average BCom guy start getting 25-30K month on month. He has every instrument to tick off. Like he have a credit card, he has got a bank account, pension account, insurance account, and everything. A mason who earns around almost 2,500 rupees, 3,000 rupees per day won't have any of these things. But he won't earn every day. His money doesn't come to his bank account. All of that. And that's where, you know, kind of a little bit more imaginative product designs about how can we get these people at the time of getting his earnings, how can he plan for his future? A lot of our fellow citizens will never have the luxury of being part of a formal economy, which designs a bit of a post savings habits of whether pension, insurance, corporate-led, many comforts, which all we all been thrown into it without we really thinking about it, right? But then that's very minority of people only have that luxury. The rest of it needs to plug into a platform which design some of these things, and then these habits of small systematic investment plans work out, and small corpus kind of really work out to be kind of a good amount. And for the segment, as we rightly think, loans are the ones which help them to kind of really generate more wealth. So on one side, you grow your business and access capital at affordable rates. And then you have a systematic investment plan which takes care of your investment plan. So yeah, so these are things that I thought I'd share with this lasting thought.
Great. Thanks a lot for that, Mr. Shekhawat and Mr. Jovi. I think you made interesting points about how these accounts are being operated by their husbands or their fathers or their sons. And maybe one of the how-tos should be how to overcome patriarchy. So maybe that's one of the how-tos that should be included. So any final thoughts from you, Mr. Dwivedi?
Finally, it has to be, according to me, two important things, the macro policy and the micro realities. The people sitting like we make the policy at the macro level, the micro realities are coming from the Jobi and Shekhawat. So how well these two are merged and how well that gaps is reduced is the challenge. So my policy and designing the product. But at the same time, what are the regulators and the financial sector regulators' concerns at the macro level is the ensuring the financial stability of the country, and at the micro level, the consumer interest is protected. So these two are the guiding principles on which any product designing or any financial education material are designed. I mean, keeping these two in view and how the consumer protection is also ensured. And in doing that, as rightly said by Shekhawat, you, me, one institution, two institutions cannot do in a country of our diversity and our size and our kind of population and demography. So what is required is count me in, means you, me, everyone should contribute into the financial education initiative and the drive that the country is taking. And in the strategy, everybody should contribute. Every individual should contribute. It is a call, it should be the call of the nation that everybody should contribute and be literate, be educated yourself, and there are materials available, and then that's the way you can contribute to the whole effort and the initiatives of the government, the regulators, and the everybody, and the financial sectors and the non-financial sectors as well.
Great, thanks for that. You're absolutely right. The macro and the micro do need to come together, and I think platforms like these, IFI and Sankalp, hopefully play a part in doing that. So I think that brings us to the end of this session, and we are also out of time. So as a closing comment, I would just like to thank Priyam Vada and IFI team for organizing this. And thank you again to all our panelists. This was really enriching.